Well, as we begin taping tonight, we're looking out on this vivid sunset, just really spectacular. As really the sun sets on September, and we get ready to forge into October, all right? So this is our focus. Our focus is very positive now. You might even call it a post-apocalyptic time. You might even say the apocalypse has already occurred and that the veil has been lifted. We've done a very good job lifting that veil and seeing what's going on. We now know, really, that there is this global agenda, and without any question, for the next 15 years, there is a blueprint. There has been this funneling towards this. The whole world's being funneled towards this. And this is where the world is heading. So we now are prepared to pay attention to another option. So the option of October. October should help us, should reveal what our option is, what our options are. We want an option other than getting funneled into this global agenda for the aiming for 2030. And I was told long ago, shown, that when Volkswagen takes a severe tumble, there's a severe tumble involving Volkswagen. That is the time where we go back to paradise, so to speak. We take this option of turning back around and no longer going down this road and going back to where we came from. And indeed, this amazingly has happened. And, you know, the blood moon, the fourth of blood moon, actually happened on the evening of the 27th. On the internet, it said the 28th when I looked it up. So I got some misinformation. It was actually the 27th, 28th, but it was the night of the 27th. So this fourth blood moon happened with a super moon, which means the moon is closest to the Earth at that point. And this is supposed to be in prophecy when Jesus returns, is when this fourth blood moon and a series of Jewish holidays occurs. So it's already occurred. I had a terrible night last night. I didn't think I'd be able to get through it. Finally, I was able to calm down by doing spiritual practice. It was the only way. So I know that something, you know, this is very profound. It happened on the very end of the Sustainable Goal Development Summit. Sustainable Development Goals Summit. As part of Agenda 21. It happened right, that fourth blood moon happened right on the end of that summit. It's just amazing, the timing of September. So we're ready to put September in our rearview mirror as we adjust to October. October is the month of options. Okay, the month of options. So we're looking now for options. Now, today, when I found out that the blood moon had already happened, I said, wow, today's the day. And so I expected something really dramatic to happen, but the Holy Spirit has its own ideas of what is dramatic. It's more gentle and subtle, but something did happen, which got my full attention on realizing we must go positive now. We must begin to focus in on what is our option to what the world agenda is, where it's trying to take us, where it's trying to funnel us into, what it's trying to funnel us into. And to put it in the most succinct way possible, it's trying to funnel us into an obsession with outcomes. A very, very strong fixation with focusing on outcomes. And what the Holy Spirit says our option is to allow ourselves to experience now, in which there are no outcomes taking place at all. And in fact, everything is now, in the now, right now. Everything's in the now. And it's not even therefore things, there's just the now. There's just the now. I am the now. And I got some sort of sudden glimpse of feeling, oh, I got a feeling for it. The vision of the now, vision of the now. Which is a vision of no outcomes taking place. There are no outcomes taking place at all. Reality is outcome free. And this, what we're seeing, even though it's a dreamlike perception, it's also outcome free. And the sunset is getting even more intense there. Extraordinary. The sun is setting on a previous cycle, isn't it? The sun is setting because it's now full blast ahead with an obsession, obsessive focus on outcomes. And this is the opposite of vision of now, true vision. It's the opposite. It takes us in the opposite, it's the opposite focus. So again, I was shown that when there's a severe tumble regarding Volkswagen, this, you will know, this is then the time when you return back to paradise, which is really the paradise of now, seeing the now, experiencing the now, experiencing nowness, which means freedom from all outcomes. There is no outcome in nowness. It's just all right now. Everything is as it is right now. The presence of right now stands revealed. So for the first time, I got this feeling of, oh, okay. That we're perceptually imagining outcomes that aren't really present. They're not really there. There's only the now. Everything is always in the now. There aren't any outcomes. And so our delusion is to believe in outcomes, which is really believe in concretization. So we're not seeing correctly at all. We're not seeing at all correctly. So Volkswagen has taken a most severe tumble. So this is when we now focus on the option of now. It's such a severe tumble that people are predicting, you know, some sort of drastic trouble for Volkswagen. They're going to be severely afflicted for quite some time. And this is what I was shown about 12 years ago. And I thought, how could that possibly be, something around Volkswagen taking a severe tumble? And then lo and behold, this week, it has actually happened. And so I'm so shocked by this, I couldn't hardly sleep, because I know that we are now in the time where we need to go get back to what we're really about, get back to where we came from, so to speak, is the land of no outcomes whatsoever, which is the land of reality. And reality is extremely beautiful, even in this perceptual mode that we're imagining. See, perception believes in outcomes. So in order to keep perception, temporarily at least, and still be aware of now, we see the structure of our belief in outcomes as if it were flattened. So this is honoring our creativity. So we can be aware of the now, no outcomes at all, and yet our clever creativity in believing in outcomes still has some presence, but in a flattened way. And this will become evident to us as we go forward. And now the sunset is pretty much finished, and now it's getting dark. It may seem that this is extraordinarily abstract. Well, to say there are no outcomes, that is abstraction, isn't it? To say there are no outcomes at all, that you might say that's the very essence of pure abstraction. Even abstraction is not an outcome. But for the sake of continuity, we might say that it is both is an outcome and is not an outcome. Okay, we don't want to completely leave all structure that we're used to behind. That's too much of a continuity issue. So we could say pure abstraction both is and is not an outcome. And leave it at that. So we don't have to totally commit to no outcome. We can see it, we can experience it, but we don't have to totally commit, which would be knowing. We can still imagine ourselves deep perceiving. Well, say, well, it's both is and is not an outcome. So this doesn't commit either way, does it? And since it doesn't commit either way, the reality itself, what is already present. So that's what we'd be aware of, but we'd still not be completely committed in our mind, so to speak. It's like a temperature. You go outside, well, I say, well, it both is and it isn't. I'm both committed to a temperature and not committed to a temperature. Someone might ask you, well, what's the temperature? What does it feel like? Well, it both, you know, feels like this and doesn't feel like this. So we're not committed, we're not completely committed, and yet we're still feeling the temperature. Let's say it's like a 90 degrees or whatever the temperature is. We'd still be feeling the 90 degrees. We're just saying, well, it both is 90 degrees, both is and isn't 90 degrees. It both is 90 degrees and isn't 90 degrees. It's neither 90 degrees nor is it not 90 degrees. So this would be like our expression. We'd still have a conceptual framework, even though it's zeroed out, so to speak, it's flattened. It's still sort of like a memory of a framework, right? Of a structure. Like a symbol of outcomes without the outcome. It both is and is not an outcome. It both is and is not an outcome. So the temperature, we'd still feel the temperature. But there would still be some, you know, sort of slight, subtle detachment or non-commitment. We're neither committed nor not committed, this kind of thing. It's not like a complete positive. There's a subtle difference, this intermediate step. It's not a knowing, it's like a perceiving rather than knowing. We're still feeling the 90 degrees. But we say we're perceiving the 90 degrees. It's the 90 degrees, we both are and are not perceiving it. So this doesn't get rid of perception altogether. We say, well, I'm perceiving that it both is and isn't. I'm perceiving that there's both outcomes and no outcomes. I'm receiving no outcome and not no outcome. I'm perceiving neither an outcome nor not an outcome. And yet I'm feeling what is without dropping all labels altogether, all definitions, all labels altogether. So we still keep a definition, which is both it is and it isn't. It's both free of outcome, both, there's both no outcomes and not no outcomes. It's neither an outcome nor not an outcome. I'm neither seeing outcomes nor am I not seeing outcomes. So this is a definition, okay, of what we're experiencing, which is just like a zero. You know, say I just don't really have a definite definition. So it's sort of like an indefinite definition. I have this completely indefinite definition of what I'm experiencing. And then this sort of like a transparent veil. It's like a veil, but a transparent veil. This is a very good way of putting it. It's a transparent veil. The veil is still there, but it's transparent. It's like, imagine a curtain that you think is hiding something behind the curtain, and yet the curtain is like totally transparent. Well, you'd still be seeing what's behind the curtain, but you also say, well, there is a curtain there. There is a veil, but it's transparent. So a transparent veil, as a way of putting it, transparent veil. And so we could say, well, we don't know for sure. We don't ultimately know, but we're certainly experiencing. Keep the definition. It both is and isn't. That's the definition that we're what we're experiencing. Sure, I'm both experiencing and not experiencing. Now. This is what the Holy Spirit has aimed us towards. We realize that we cannot define what we are, and yet we believe that our functioning is pretending that we're some definition, and so we're not going to drop the entire package of definition forever, and realize that it's never existed and never will, and any even memory of it is completely obliterated. Not, you know, we're not trying for that. That's beyond the scope of what we can aim for here. We can aim, though, for a zeroed out definition. I both am and am not. This both is and is not, definitionally. A transparent veil. So our goal is not just the now. Is our goal is the experience of this transparent veil, and we may initially see it as if the veil is reflecting the now, we might see it as a mirror, we might say, well, this is a mirror, but it's like a transparent mirror. Another way of putting it. It seems as though it's some reflection. Ultimately, we'll realize it's actually no reflection at all. But from our standpoint, it might seem like an empty mirror. You know, it's seems as though it's reflecting in a mirror, except it's not. So we see the frame around a mirror, like, okay, there's a mirror there. And we think what we're seeing is, oh, that's his reflection from the mirror. But actually, ultimately, we will find out that it's an empty frame. There's no mirror there at all. And we're actually knowing that this is true. It's not a mere reflection. These are ways of getting used to it, what our aim is. If we have this transparent veil, we might think that the veil is somehow involved with an outcome. It somehow could be. We say, well, but both is and it isn't. What we're experiencing, it both involves the veil and does not involve the veil. And this satisfies our continuity fear. This is what I believe in the Holy Spirit is getting us to. This brings us a satisfaction, like, it's okay, I can accept this experiencing I'm having by saying, well, it's both being caused by the veil and not being caused by the veil. The veil has something causative to it and not something causative to it. It's both, you know, coloring it and not coloring it, tinging it and not tinging it. It both has something to do with it and not something to do with it. We could say there's both a mirror. There's both a mirror there and is not a mirror there. There's neither a mirror nor is there not a mirror. There's neither a veil nor is there not a veil. So what we're trying to do is make it easier for ourselves, because we, otherwise the continuity fear will bulk. You're like a stubborn mule, and we won't get to experience. We'll get to experience the nowness. We will dig in our heels and end up in some sort of fixation mode. Okay, aim for some sublime fixation instead of actually experiencing the now. But we consciously and intentionally accept this, both neither is nor is notness, then this enables us then to, something with the continuity fear says, ah, okay, that's good. That's good enough. One more, please. This may seem a bit awkward as we're expressing it, but we've been going over and over this, but it's very important. It actually gives us confidence. You can also say, I am both, there's both an I and not an I experiencing this. When they say, well, who is asking the question? We say, well, there's both an asker and not an asker of the question. So this is the ultimate answer to the non-dual approach, is saying, well, you know, who is asking? You know, where is the I? Well, there both is an I and is not an I. There both is an asker of the question and not an asker of the question. See, our trouble is we've been trying to resolve this question of who is asking the question. And this is not the way at all. I mean, you don't resolve the question. The way of resolving the question is to not resolve it by saying, well, it's both resolved and not resolved. I'm both resolving and not resolving. I'm neither resolving it nor am I not resolving it. There's neither an asker of the question, nor is there not an asker of the question. So this is a solution that we haven't thought about much, right? We don't hear this. We keep thinking, you know, I need to answer. Okay, who's asking the question? I need to find out who is there. Someone asking the question. What is asking the question? No, there both is and is not an asker of the question. Who is experiencing the now? There both is and is not an experiencer of the now. What is the now? There both is and is not a now. And so all these questions that we have are both answered and not answered. Indeed, it's our searching for the answer, our resolution, that gets in the way. Because really, this just reinforces our belief in outcome. Ultimately, what we're trying to do is drop all belief in outcome. But doing it directly is too much continuity fear. We end up subtly believing that we've attained some outcome. So what we have to avoid the fixation, which has been defeating us over and over and over and over. This is what has been defeating us. So we say that, well, there both is and is not an outcome. And this should be producing a huge wow. It certainly is with me right now, because we've never quite heard this put in the context of all the spiritual pathness. We keep thinking that we need to, you know, reach an outcome. Well, who is asking the question? Nobody. We say no one is. You know, well, they're both no one and not no one asking the question. to say, this has never occurred to me in this context, to put it in this context. And in doing so, it's feeling extraordinarily powerful. The wow is just roaring. But we're used to allowing this to happen, so we just let it roar. It's like you're used to a lion roaring or an elephant trumpeting. Speaking of that, we're used to it, and so we just let it happen now. We're not, it doesn't unnerve us. You know, the roar certainly shakes us up. The roar of the wow shakes us up, but it does not unnerve us. This is a big difference here between being shaken up. It's like going to like the waterfalls, like in Yosemite National Park. Who knows, if the El Nino strikes this year, they may be roaring. Maybe I'll go up there. I've been up there before in a really wet year. And you walk up close to this waterfall, and the power and the noise is just extraordinary as it hits the water, hits the rocks. And you cannot help but be shaken up by this experience there. And yet, if you've done it before, and you're experienced in this, and you realize, well, I'm safe where I am, and so other people are there doing it, you don't necessarily lose your nerve. You don't get your nerves all, shaken up badly. So you still feel, there's still some calm, and within that calm, there's this enormous reverberation happening. More or less like being in a very secure home or dwelling where there's a huge storm raging. The thunder is hitting, right? You're kind of, it reverberates and you're shaken up by the thunder, but you don't lose your nerve. You're shaken up, but you don't lose your nerve. Shaken, but not stirred. You don't get all, mixed up. No, you're still calm. You're still calm. There's an inner calm, and yet there's also this wow, the roar of the lion, the trumpeting of the elephants, the thundering of this big waterfall. Now the key to getting close to that big waterfall without losing your nerve, having your nerves shaken, is to stop periodically as you're getting closer to it and just experience it from a distance. That's what I did. And then you walk a little further, stop again and experience it there until you feel relaxed and calm about it, and then go a little closer. And gradually this way you get closer and closer and closer until ultimately you can be very close and still, just not be, unnerved by it. This is really the spiritual path. We get closer and closer and closer and closer to the vision of now. And we allow ourselves to, periodically we stop, take a little break, and get accustomed to the closeness that we are, very close. A way of expressing this would be like the centerless center. I'm in the centerless center, right? Or I'm neither in the center nor not in the center. There's neither a center nor is there not a center. As soon as we define a center, we're not in the center. The center is everywhere, ultimately. Ultimately, there's not even a definition of a center or not a center. There's just the nowness. There's only the nowness. So thinking of it in terms of a center, which we can do, we have to think of it in terms of it's the centerless center, or it's neither a center nor is it not a center, or it's both a center and not a center. I'm dwelling in that which is both that and not that. I'm dwelling in the that which is both that and not that. From the standpoint of familiarity, definitional familiarity, which is all expressions that we give are assumed to be definitional here. Continuity assumes all of that. Familiarity assumes all of it. So it's backwards to try and get rid of that. We just, you know, is acknowledge. It's like keeping numbers, except we just say, well, they're all flattened into zero. But all the numbers that we've multiplied by zero, we still are aware of those, except it's all flat now. It's all, we realize that any number times zero is zero. And we're still, you know, I can see 20 is there and all these other numbers are there, but it's all flat. So this is the approach. A spiritual path is really a spiritual approach. It's maybe better to use the term approach. It's not really a path. It's more of an approach. You could say path, but approach may be closer to it, you know. We're approaching knowingness, okay? But we're not going to actually get to knowingness. But we're going to approach it and get very close. By saying, well, we're both close and not close. Problem in trying to resolve, like a Zen koan or something, is you think that silence is the answer. It's not, because as long as we think silence is the answer, we're in some subtle fixation. The silence is both. It both is and is not the answer. There both is and is not an answer to it. The koan. The puzzle. So we don't say that the rope is a rope. We say, well, it both is and is not a snake. It both is neither a snake. It's neither a snake nor is it not a snake. And so we let the feeling of it tell us what it is. It's ultimately the experiencing of it is what it is. See, ultimately it's the experiencing of it is what it is. But in order to prevent us from fixating on a definition, we intentionally put definition into this neither nor format. And we can say it both is and is not a rope. It's both resolved and is not resolved. The snake is both gone and not gone. The rope is both present and not present. So we need to practice this way definitionally. If we were to discard definition entirely, there'd be zero need to practice. We'd go instantly from our terrible self-delusion instantly into knowing. And no one is going to do that. We're not going to do that. And we're deceiving, we're fooling ourselves if we think we're going to do that. What we end up is in a subtle fixation, waiting for some very subtle outcome, believing this is what will bring happiness to us, and it never happens. You see so many on the spiritual path, you can see they're still waiting for an outcome. And you'd say, well, I did the best I could, and you know, I'm trying to abide in silence, I'm trying to, you know, and yet you can see a certain passivity to them where you can feel they're actually waiting for an outcome. Instead of practicing this neither norness, okay? Because this neither norness is disturbing. I mean, it gives us this wow. And of course, those who are waiting for an outcome can put on an act like they're in silence, you know, they're meditating in silence. And this is part of the subtlety of camouflaging, providing the camouflage, so it makes the waiting for an outcome seem subtle, and as if it's not really happening, and yet it is, and not really, you know, fixated, yet it is a fixation. So we're here, you know, struggling away, like, wow, this is just, it's like I'm shaken up by this, you know, trumpet of this elephant, wow. And people might say, wow, they're not very advanced there, you know, they don't really know how to sit in silence or whatever, you know, they can't do this. But this is not the case. This is actually the more advanced approach. Now, once the now is seen, we're not sitting in silence so much. You could say that, but we're sitting in the now. But we would say, well, we're both sitting and not sitting in the now. We're both abiding and not abiding in the now. And yet, the feeling of abidance is there. So you can't go on the form of anyone, there's someone sitting there silent. You cannot go on that form. As Ramana Maharshi said, it is only the felt peace around the saint that is saturating, permeating the air where the saint is. That's the only way to really recognize, is there really a saint here or not? You cannot go on anything else. So the saint may be silent or not silent, may be active or not active. Oftentimes we adopt a symbol of the now and then fixate on that symbol, and think that this is an outcome that is triumphing over other outcomes, which will make me, the triumph will make me happy, that is superior to other outcomes. Whereas truth is, in reality, there's no outcomes. So happiness is not based on any outcome whatsoever. How could it be? So we're really getting this approach. You know, we're the ones who are actually getting it done here by this. And you know, we're struggling as we feel this, wow, to, oh my gosh. Yet this is the fast way. This is the fast way. This is what actually works. This is fast tracking. So we always say the answer or the outcome is neither now nor not now. And of course, this frustrates our reliance on outcomes, doesn't it? And yet it's the crutch. It's a crutch which enables us to truly experience the now by not trying to totally discard outcomes by saying, well, this neither an outcome nor is it not an outcome. It's the outcome-free outcome. Keep practicing in this way. And we're not trying to have a breakthrough. As long as we're trying to have some breakthrough, we're looking for an outcome. So our focus should be on the practice, not on some breakthrough. It's focusing on a breakthrough which leads to fixation. Because we would say, well, it's both a breakthrough and not a breakthrough. It's neither a breakthrough nor is it not a breakthrough. there's both a breakthrough here and not a breakthrough. There's neither a breakthrough here, nor is there not a breakthrough. So we keep using definition in this way, instead of trying to discard definition altogether. I believe this is the fast track pathway, the successful way, the sure way. But while we're doing this, we seem, you know, inferior, like the lower vehicle, Hinayana, lower vehicle here. Oh, these poor people toiling away with, you know, the lower vehicle. It's not the lower vehicle. It both is and is not the lower vehicle. It both is and is not the higher vehicle. And it both is and is not a vehicle. As our minds get used to using this neither nor definitional structure, then this makes room, as it were, for, it stabilizes us for actually feeling and experiencing, actually experiencing it, actual experience, rather than the definition of an experience, the now, actually experiencing the now, actually abiding in the now. Because definitionally we would say, well, we're both neither abiding nor are we not abiding. We're neither abiding nor are we not abiding. So you can see how this path is extraordinarily different than the Agenda 21 path, the agenda for the 21st century, and what their, you know, their obsession with outcomes. This does not help us experience the now. This completely mitigates against it, actually. Because what we need to be doing is what we're doing right here. This is what we need to be doing. And there's not one iota of emphasis upon this in any part of Agenda 21. The Sustainable Development Goals. The blueprint for the 21st century, which is what the world, the movers and shakers and leaders of the world are, have decided that this is the future that we all want. Well, we would say we both want it and don't want it. We neither want it nor do we not want it. This would be our practice. So what we need to do is put everything into the form of a practice. And of course, this frustrates goal fixation, outcome fixation, doesn't it? Which is exactly what we need to practice. We need to get comfortable with this ultimate frustration of goal fixation. And we can say, well, I'm neither fixated nor non-fixated. Yes, I'm both fixated and non-fixated. Yes, I'm neither fixated nor non-fixated. And when we do this, this frustration of goal fixation, you know, it's like a burn. It's get a burn. So you're feeling the burn of this. And then there's a wow reaction to this also. Like, hey, this is really working. Holy cow, this actually is what works. Now, those with severe goal fixation, which is virtually everyone, they might say, they're scared of this. They say, no, we don't want it to work. We want just one goal. We want to reach at least one goal. That's the goal that I am working on. I feel I've reached this one goal, and I just want it recognized. I'm just waiting for the world to recognize that I reached this goal. And so there's resistance to this. And yet the path, the approach of repentance is to recognize that this is the problem that I have, and I have to practice my way free of this problem. I cannot outcome my way free of this problem. I cannot get recognition. I can't gain enough recognition for my fixation to truly be happy. It can never happen. So wherever you are, you might be the president, the pope, you might be some guru. You might be this or might be this, non-dual teacher, whatever. At least in the eyes of the world. You may have attained an outcome of recognition from the world. Okay, this is the problem. You do not want to attain an outcome of recognition from the world as far as you're concerned. Because that is fixation. That's where you get stuck in fixation, thinking I've reached an outcome and now my happiness is going to arrive from recognition that, oh, look at this great attainment. Now it does not happen from recognition from others, so to speak. It's allowing the experiencing of now, which is no outcome at all. So people come to those who are in the now, experiencing the now, and they basically say, well, I've come here to recognize your great attainment, your great accomplishment, but I can't quite understand what it is. Could you explain it to me so I can recognize it and make you, you know, fully happy? You're lacking something, which is my recognition. And of course, they just, you know, say, well, I both can explain it and cannot explain it. It's both an attainment and not an attainment. I both arrived and I have not arrived. And they say, well, I can't quite understand. I don't see the outcome that you've reached. You know, I don't see the outcome here. I need for you. You need to explain it to me so I can recognize. Because without my recognition, it's not complete. And I say, well, they're both is and is not a completeness. They're both is and is not a recognition. They're both is and is not a need. And of course, this shakes them up because they themselves feel that their recognition of the teacher is itself an accomplishment, an outcome for them, which then can be recognized by others. This is why in coming to satsang, coming to whatever you want to call it, you're coming to hear the roar of the lion, the burn, and the wow of having this outcome fixation frustrated. And it's how you look at this, that is a glass half empty or glass half full, makes all the difference. If you can say, ah, this is what I've come for, great. The burn, wonderful. My glass is half full here. This is, in other words, this is true progress. This is real progress here. We're really getting to it. The frustration of outcome fixation is, I'm feeling it. And then just allow yourself to feel it. This is what you come for. This is what everyone really comes for. Who, you know, who, the wise, those who are fast tracking. This is what they. This is how to look at it. Now maybe people think they got murfed. You know, they say, I thought this was the fast line, but it turned out to be the slow. No, the slow line is the fast line. Because on the other line, you know, it may give the appearance of going fast, but at some point, there's fixation. And you never actually get to the cashier, you know. You might go real fast, then suddenly, oh, stop. You know, I can't go any further. And hey, look, everybody, look how fast I went. You know, then look at this outcome. I was on a real fast line. But, of course, you haven't gotten through the cashier, you know. The fixation is there. So it actually turns out to be the slow line. So I'm feeling this intense burn right now, which is great. So I thank the Holy Spirit for that. I'm truly thankful. Both truly thankful and not thankful. I'm neither thankful nor am I not thankful. So we can use any expression definition, which is an outcome, really. Definitions are by actually a belief in outcomes. I'm thankful. I've arrived at the outcome of thankfulness. We can use any definition to practice with, actually. But we don't have to use every definition to practice. I mean, if we can practice to the point where the wow is so strong, then we don't have to. We can just use words without turning them into practice. You see? We're in charge of our practice that way. We don't need to be foolishly consistent because the purpose is to experience this frustration and let it get used to it and gradually say, okay, I'm okay with this frustration. I'm okay with it. It doesn't bother me as much as I thought. There's a calm still within. That's the goal. The practice in itself is not the goal. The means it's not an end in itself. The means are not an end in itself. So we don't need to be, you know, reach an outcome of practicing, right? It's an art. It's not a science. Because the temptation is to say, well, yeah, okay, I practice. I used every single word, you know, the way you told me to do, like that. So I reached an outcome of practicing successfully. So now I can fixate there and get others to recognize this. I'll get the recognition coming to this. Obviously, that's, you know, we're fooling ourselves there. So we practice, then we ease off the practice. Then we go back to practicing, then we ease off. And it's not some rigorous academic science. It's an art. When we feel that maybe I could slip in a little more practice, then we slip it in. When we feel that it's too intense, I've reached the saturation. I'm so, you know, frustrated. My outcomes, you know, belief in outcomes is so frustrated. Wow, I can't take any more right this moment. Then you just back off and just talk as normal. You know, maybe chat about the weather. And that too can be a frustration for those who are trying to reach an outcome of practicing properly. that's a frustration too. So, have to be aware of the wow and look at it as glass half full, and then you're doing great. You're doing great. Can't do any better than that. Doing great. And we say, well, we're both doing great and not doing great. But getting familiar with this frustration is ultimately what will allow spontaneously the awareness of the now will be there spontaneously for us without us trying to get it as an outcome. As soon as we try to grasp the now as an outcome, the now disappears. Of course, because there is no outcome to grasp. And we cannot grasp this outcome either, that it's ungraspable. So we say it both is graspable and not graspable. Graspable is not graspable. It's both graspable and not graspable. It's neither graspable nor is it not graspable. It's graspable. And not graspable, about graspable. It's a graspable-ableness, and not a graspable-ableness. And you can have a little joke with yourself like this. Of course, it's not necessary, really, to do that. But it's a little humor. That's spiritual humor right there. It's not graspable. Neither is it graspable-able. So much to our amazement, right on the heels of this most intense week in history, the tipping point of history, actually. We've just gone through the tipping point of history, punctuated by the last of this, the tetrad blood moon, the fourth blood moon. Putting a bow on it all. And here we are in this very righteous, effective practice, you know. So this shows that we're in great shape. You know, this is just tremendous. It shows that we've taken the right approach, and the warnings have been right, to, you know, the urgency and everything is to get to this practice before, you know, we were into this before this week actually happened, weren't we? We were already familiar enough with it, so this week did not knock us out. We did not get knocked out. Now you say, well, maybe you wonder, maybe you're knocked out or not. Well, the mind is one, so any not knocked outness is not knocked outness. It's present. It's present. And the more of that not knocked outness that is present, you know, the more helpful it is, really, the more reassurance there is. So at least there's this one instance here of not knocked outness, which is enough. If there's one instance, there can be more, right? So at least we have this, that we're not knocked out here. Night, it was trying to knock me out, and I finally returned to, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I both can. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can, I will, I've already done it. I've neither done it nor have I not done it. And by going into these practices, I was able to finally stabilize and go to sleep. But boy, were my nerves shaken up last night. I realized that this is a danger time here. My nerves were getting shaken up. But I said, well, okay, it just is what it is, and let's just keep practicing and it will smooth out. And it is smoothing out into this, wow. Maybe my nerves were saying, I don't know if I can really keep practicing, you know, very strongly. And by doing it, you know, I'm relieved, I'm relaxed. Oh, this is great. We can still do this. Our practice didn't get knocked out, okay, by this intense tipping point of history. That's their hope. That's their goal. They're hoping that they delivered a knockout blow, and they didn't. We dodged it. Now, the ferocity of the knockout blow was unnerving. It's like someone tries to land a blow, and it just misses you. You know, you can just be shaken up for a while, but actually it missed you completely. So there's no real impact, but just the thought, like, oh my gosh, what if that had hit me? You know, this can really shake us up a bit. Just like I had the experience of that rock. I shifted my position and a rock, big rock, whizzed right past my head. And I said, oh my gosh, if I hadn't shifted my position a little bit, you know, it would have, you know, gone right through my skull. And then it's kind of like, shaken up after that, even though, you know, I was fine. So it's kind of like that right now. We dodged the blow. You know, they tried to land a knockout blow, it missed. We sidestepped it and it missed. And yet we're still kind of like, wow, you know, wow, that was close. That was a close call. But we made it. And wow, you know, we're just sitting here in this recognition. We did not fixate on any sublime outcome, did we? We're still practicing neither nor here. practicing the non-attachment to any outcomes. Where we're both non-attached and not non-attached. So we do that by saying we're both non-attached and we're both attached and not attached. We're neither attached nor are we non-attached. I am neither attached nor am I non-attached to outcomes. I'm neither attached to outcomes nor am I not attached to outcomes. Remember, it's not attachment or non-attachment to outcomes that we're aiming for to experience. We're aiming to experience the now, which is inherently has no outcomes, and it's not, it did not attain this state of not having outcomes. It was created this way from the very beginning. So our aim is to experience that which is the isness of the now, which is effortlessly so, without any self-reflection of it being so, without any need of it being labeled so. And yet it is so without us reaching any definite conclusion about it. We do not have to reach a conclusion about reality for reality to be real. We can say, I've neither reached a conclusion nor have I not reached a conclusion. Or I both have reached a conclusion and have not reached a conclusion. You can use these both and either interchangeably. They're both very powerful. I've neither reached a conclusion nor have I not reached a conclusion. So there's this intense, you know, frustration, but we take it in a very positive light. We understand what we're doing. And as we sit here quietly, we're proving to ourselves, hey, I'm not really shaken up by this. I'm just experiencing this familiarity, continuity, fear. It's evaporating as I sit here quietly. It's evaporating. So that's all I have to do. Just let it evaporate. Now it seems that those are, you know, in a big hurry, like in some of the non-dual approaches, etc., they try to bring you to some sort of existential crisis of extreme frustration, where you finally just say, just the frustration is not worth it, I'm just going to forget all about it. But I as of yet, I do not see that as, you know, the appropriate way. Respect, you know, our creativity and how much continuity fear it's been able to present to us, and let the continuity fear evaporate. It seems like the slow approach, doesn't it? It seems a lot more glamorous to try to bring ourselves to some breaking point of such extreme frustration that we just drop all resistance, so to speak. But you know, this doesn't seem to be a safe way to go about it. This could very well end up in some very subtle fixation. See, we're not making any claims. We're both making claims and not making claims. We're both making claims and not making claims. Because our goal is abidance. We're not trying to gain recognition. We're both trying to gain recognition and not trying to gain recognition. Which leaves us with what? Abidance. What's the residue of this practice? Abidance, you could say. Because there's no residue. There both is and is not a residue. There both is and is not a trace. It seems like we're going beyond everything that we've been taught, even the sublime teachings. You know, this seems to be just something else. And it both is and is not something else. As soon as we try to fixate, keep saying, well, it both is and isn't, you know, that then keep dissolving the fixation. No matter how sublime we might, you know, take it to be, it both is and is not sublime. It neither is sublime nor is it not sublime. It's neither effective nor is it not effective. So what we're doing here is we're trusting an isness that doesn't need any success for it to be what it is. We're not trying to gain an outcome in any way. We have faith that there's this outcome-free, inherently outcome-free isness of nowness that we will experience when we become comfortable enough to say, well, I'm both experiencing and not experiencing this. This is the difficulty of this world, right? We have to stay in abidance even though we're functioning in this world. So we have to see it both as an outcome and not an outcome. And this is how we remain in abidance. I'm both in abidance and not in abidance. Because people will be saying, well, you know, I don't want to interrupt your abidance, you know, that you take it that your abidance has been interrupted, you know. Well, it's both been interrupted and not interrupted. I can listen to this message now. otherwise, we'll get frustrated. One moment here. Okay, so this is a perfect opportunity for me to practice this. I've both been practicing and not practicing. I both have been reaching the wow and not reaching there. I both reached a wow and not reached the wow. In other words, I need to go do something, help someone out. So I don't want to say, I have to stop this practice. Well, I both am stopping and not stopping the practice. See, I'm both stopping and not stopping the practice. So keep this feeling of frustrating fixation on any outcome, including the outcome of not fixating on outcomes. I'm neither succeeding nor not succeeding. Ah, we've reached over an hour. Okay, it's very good, very good. It's both very good and not very good. It's neither very good nor not very good. But it's enough for the roar of the lion, the thundering of the waterfall to be heard within the burn and the wow. So, wow. Yeah, this is very intense. This is great. And just, you know, just live with it. Just live with that. Just wear it. And when you wear anything, eventually you get used to it, right? Eventually you get used to it like it's not even there. Like a backpack. At first you put it on, it's so heavy. But if you keep wearing that backpack long enough, you don't even feel it eventually. You just hardly feel it at all. And this is, it's like that. It's both like that and not like that. Okay, great. We dodged the punch. We're still standing. We're fine, but we're a little shaken up that such a tremendous haymaker was thrown at us. Great, very great. Okay, that's it for this one.